Once again, we're very blessed to have Rusty Joyner here. We met him at the Calvary Chapel, like Gerald said, the Calvary Chapel Association's pastor's conference. And you know Pastor Gerald, he walks around and shakes every person's hand the best that he can. And he does the same thing everywhere he goes. It doesn't matter if it's at the grocery store or whether it's at a pastor's conference, he does that. And so it's been passed down to all pastoral staff here. So we do that as well. And so we actually had a break from doing that at the pastor's conference to sit down at a table, and who do we see but this gentleman right here, Rusty Joyner, walking up to every table, shaking people's hands and saying, "Hi, how are you doing? I'm Rusty." And so that's how we actually got a good chance to meet him, and we scheduled him out months ago to come out here today. And it's going to be an absolutely just fantastic message we're excited to have. But before we do that, let's go ahead and play the trailer for the movie that will be going on tonight so you guys can kind of know who he is.
Let's give a warm welcome to our new community outreach leader, Jesse Dean.
It says here that you work at a church now. So an Army Ranger who's now running an outreach at a church in the city.
I'm thinking of starting some boxing training.
Boxing at a church.
Step four. Jeff, step aside. You grab the wrist. Good job.
I'm referring to the clinic that's across the street.
It's a family planning clinic, right?
And they also have about 5 to 20 abortions a day.
And what are we doing? I'll tell you what we're doing. Nothing.
Is someone addressing the situation?
I just told you I'm working on it.
Will I see my baby in heaven?
You don't have to do this.
Church has changed, Jesse. We've become more like a lamp tucked under a basket rather than a light on top of a hill.
You know what something like this can do to a church?
Protesting, reporters, now a death across the street.
There's been death across the street for the past 6 months.
Never question where God is leading you, even if sometimes it's a bit uncomfortable.
This is what God would want, Julia.
Are you sure it's God leading you or just guilt?
It's all penance, my friend.
When you have a chance to save someone's life and they die, don't you always feel like you could have done more to help?
Keep doing your boxing, Mr. Dean. At least you're swinging at something.
This is what you were talking about, right? Take action.
Isn't it our responsibility to protect these children, regardless of the consequences?
This is about being a voice for the voiceless.
Rusty Joyner.
Get this turned on there. Thank you, Pastor Gerald. No, I'm kidding. Who is that guy? No. Thank you so much, Pastor BJ and his lovely wife we met last night for hosting us this weekend to come out and see you guys up here at Joshua Tree. We're so excited to be here. Man, the Thunderdome, is that what you called this place? This is awesome. Look what God did. Isn't that great? Man, everywhere I go, I look around and I'm amazed that this came from God through you here. So, wow, what a great job you guys have done, and what a great worship team you have. We're from the South, so we kind of grew up with worship music. My wife went to a full-blown gospel church, almost Pentecostal, so 2 hours of this, you know, and you're like, wow, I can't feel my hands, but you guys have such a good worship team, so what a great way to kind of get into what God's hoping to do. So, Father God, I pray right now, no matter what happens in this room this morning, you are present, you are here, you're alive in us, and I just pray you anoint anything I say, anything we hear, just wash it in the blood of Jesus so it is true and it lands and it changes our lives as we walk out that door and share the truth with the world. And that truth is your love, Jesus. Thank you so much. Amen. So then, thanks for having us so much. Yeah, this guy up here, he looks much taller in person, doesn't he? I hear that everywhere you go. They show the trailer and shaking hands like, you look much bigger on TV. So that's why I wear tight clothes, to see if it makes me look a little bit bigger and more tough. I told that this morning service, I don't get to dress up a lot because I do a lot of action movies, and most times it's in a tight t-shirt or something, so I don't get to wear my nice stuff all the time. And I forgot how tight skinny jeans were, skinny And I had two more cookies over there, and they got even tighter. I was like, how did that happen? How did that happen? So I took out my chapstick and my keys, and this morning service, I went ahead and put them in my wife's purse because I just couldn't even get in the pockets this time. So grateful to be here, guys. So grateful to be here to talk to you this morning about something that's just changing our world, crushing our world, and that's the whole pro-life movement. And unfortunately for us, just like the term Christianity, we aren't the ones telling the world what it means to be Christian or what it means to be pro-life. It's the media. It's the people who stand against us, the opposition. They're defining what it means to be Christian because they're the ones talking. They're the ones out there more outspoken than we are, right? So our job through media, through this platform here, through music, is to change that. If we want the world to change the way we define Christianity, then we need to be the ones putting it out there. We need to be the ones writing the songs, putting the movies out there, but we got to put out good quality content that people want to watch. And for some reason, church movies aren't always in that category, right? So I was so blessed to be a part of this film. It really changed my life 2 years ago when we released. And since then, God has started an amazing ministry. I've been so blessed to travel the country and just a regular guy. As you can already tell, I'm not a pastor. So I won't blow you away today with any kind of sermon. I'm a husband, I'm a father, I'm a man of God who heard him speak and say, go do something for me. So here I am. And I think that he wants all of us to do that because we're all regular people. Praying daily, God, well, what are my strengths? What are my gifts? What can I do? And God just says, take a step. I just want you to take a step. So when you guys get a chance to watch this tonight, it's so well done. It's well done. It's a small budget film, a beautiful, small, independent movie that just kind of speaks the truth, but exactly how we as Christians, I felt, need to tell the world what it means to be pro-life. And that's truly in an imperfect way. And pro-life, for me, just means, it means pro-love. And I always knew I was pro-life. Growing up and before I knew God, but I didn't know what that meant to really mean pro-life until I had children. When you stare into your baby's face for the very first time, you thought you were pro-life. Man, are you pro-life then, for sure. So I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I'm a country kid. I've lost most of the accent, unless I'm talking to my family back at home. I was born in Alabama. I grew up in Georgia. So I'm from the real L.A., Lower Alabama. Anybody? Montgomery, anyone? Roll Tide? Yeah. All right. USCers out there? Yeah. Or not? Oh. what are we here? What is this one? We are the... We don't know that one either? Oh, the Lightning. Okay. I'm just kidding. Lightning. Okay. Go Lightning, right? Yeah. So I grew up in Georgia, a single mom in the 70s, raised three boys by herself. Tell you what, women, moms are the strongest human beings on the planet. So I applaud you. I applaud you. I thank you. I'm grateful. Can you guys hear this okay? Is it good? Okay. let's clap again for moms, man. You guys are really, really, really. So I grew up not in church. We didn't talk about God. We didn't talk about Jesus. Of course, I heard God's name. I heard Jesus. I didn't really know who they were, what they did, what they were responsible for, something called the world and creation and all that. I didn't know that growing up. But we did know love. My mom poured one thing into our family, and that was love. We didn't have much. We were broke. We were poor, but we had love. So I always kind of knew the difference between right and wrong. I think I had one foot in each, but I always leaned towards right my whole life because I know God's somewhere in there kind of crawling around all of us until we get a chance to talk with him and meet with him the very first time. And so growing up in Georgia, I grew up in a really, really, really small town. And I had a couple of friends in high school that went to church. And for me, those experiences weren't great. So I really steered away from any kind of church involvement through college just because of those bad experiences where I just felt kind of judgment coming on me like a heathen kid because we didn't go to church. And I just didn't know what it was. So I thought, wow, if that's what it means to be a Christian, I don't want to be like that. I'm a happy person. I want to spread that with people. And ultimately, I know that's what God is telling us all. So I didn't get to know God at all my early childhood through college, after college. And somehow this Georgia boy that never thought he'd even go to Florida somehow wound up in Los Angeles. You know, after college, I was an athlete, so I always worked out, and I was always a skinny kid, so I was a very, very late bloomer, so I stayed lean and ripped, and met a modeling agency in Atlanta that rep Cindy Crawford or some famous model, and they said, you know, you should be a model. And I said, what? And then 2 weeks later, there I was in Italy. This Georgia boy didn't know what he was doing, total fish out of water, in Italy, modeling, right? And that was something that kind of changed my path in life in the whole entertainment industry, because from there, I came back and it just, something worked. And I just started working nonstop. I lived in Chicago and New York and Miami and kind of traveled around all over the place. So you can imagine a 25-year-old with a pocket full of money, girls and booze everywhere, and no God and no family values. Man, where was that heading? Well, that all led to Los Angeles. My best friend always wanted to be an actor, so life needed a change when I was 25. And we moved to California, became roommates, and I'm an athlete, so you got to pour everything into being successful. And if you're going to do it, you're going to do it. And I knew I wanted to be a successful actor, so I made acting my graduate school. So I wanted to pour 4 solid years into it, a very long graduate school. 4 solid years into it, because I really needed to learn from the ground up. I didn't do theater in high school or college, but I knew this is something that I wanted to do, and I fell in love with it. But in those 4 years came everything else that Hollywood offered. A young man out here by himself with no family, no strong family values, certainly didn't know who God was. And all you had back then was what? For a young man, you had beautiful girls, Budweiser, and late nights. Just what happens in Los Angeles. And that's the world I fell into. And it was great and wonderful, and I was the envy of all my friends in Georgia. Life is so good. But that's how the world does know God. That's how they define it. Man, it just got heavy and hard and dark. And as the years went on, as the fun increased, my life just got really, really, really hard. And I think more disconnected from who I was or who I was going to become. And I didn't have God in my life. And I had this one friend of mine. He was that guy that he was my worst influence. He was a partier. He was always ready to go. And I wasn't a big drinker anyway because I was an athlete, you know. And he's the one that said, you need to go to church. What? I didn't know any different, though. And I think a lot of Christians live in Los Angeles. It's part of what we do, social lives. People go out and they drink and they do their thing. But he's the one that said, yeah, you got to go to church. And he kept talking about this church called Bel Air Presbyterian Church. It's where all the newbies from Los Angeles, all the actors that were fresh off the boat, they all kind of went and hung out. It was like a social hour. Anything and everything that was involved in fashion or what was happening, it was there. Right? Britney Spears went there. It was a really cool church. And I didn't want to go. And I remember what it was like. And I didn't want to go. I didn't know what was in here. I didn't know scripture. I didn't know verses. I didn't know how to talk Christianese, as my friends would call it. So I felt out of place. I didn't want to go. And then he said, there's pretty girls there. I said, I'm sorry, what? Yeah, I'll check it out. Full disclosure, right? Now, God, whatever it takes. So I go to this church, Bel Air Press, and walk in this magnificent, beautiful sanctuary. It would seat 2,000, 3,000 people, and it was a full house that Sunday morning. And I did what all new people do when they go to church, and mentioned this morning, is, man, I sat in the very back. Sat in the very back as far as I could away from anybody who would see me. Had my Atlanta Braves hat pulled on real, real low, hiding, making sure no one would see me because I just didn't want to feel out of place and anyone look at me and point a finger at me. And lucky for me, Pastor Mark Brewer was there, and he was on the podium, and he was wearing his Hawaiian shirt, and he was talking real casual and smart and wonderful, and he was just a wonderful man of God that just somehow spoke my language. And talking about speaking language, I got a FaceTime from Pastor Gerald this morning, and he was drinking a fresh squeezed orange juice wearing a tank top, and he wanted me to remind his staff that he's working much harder than all you guys today, so he wanted me to put that somewhere in there, just want you to know. Yeah, so he's just one of those wonderful guys, a lot like Pastor Gerald, that you wish he taught every class you ever took in college because you make a 4.0. Just that kind of person, right? For me, and I was interested, and so I started listening. And lucky for me, they started at Matthew. They wanted to start the very beginning of the New Testament and talk about it, what it meant, who Jesus was. And that was great for me because I had no clue. But he didn't go into the Bible right away. He started talking about life that was hard in Los Angeles, being a young actor, and the dangers and the pitfalls were out there, and the parties and the late nights and the fun and dating, sex before marriage and all these things, and drinking and all these things were heavy and painful and hurtful. And all of these 4 years were running around my head, everything that led to that point. I was broken at that point. I just turned 30. It was the first Sunday after my 30th birthday, and I was at the end. I was at the end. I've been in Los Angeles for many, many, many years. I'd seen all my savings from being the top of the modeling world. It's very successful. Traded all that in because I wanted to be an actor and start from scratch. And by the end, it was just, I was broken. Just gotten out of a really, really bad relationship with this girl, and first one I ever had where I fought, and it was terrible. I was broken. Pain, loss, hurt. Something we all feel, we all felt. Man, it just, something came over me, and I just started crying. There I am in the back row, this guy who doesn't even belong in that church, drunk the night before, smelling probably like alcohol, crying in the back row of this church. He kept talking about pain and hurt. Man, I started crying uncontrollably. Snot going everywhere, like the bad kind of crying, like heavy, you know? I didn't know what was happening. And then bam, in the snap of a finger, I just felt this warmth come over me. I knew Jesus came into my heart right there. That exact moment came into my life. I didn't know what that meant. I'd heard about it. I thought it was just something you see on TV when people flop on the ground. I've seen all that stuff, right? I didn't know what it was. I didn't know it was real, but man, something happened. And I felt protected and I felt safe. And everything he said, that this zoned out. And the whole time he's talking about this, he's looking right at me. There's 2,000 people in this room. How can he see me? Because I'm dodging left and I'm dodging right. And he just kept connecting with me. I don't know if God spoke to him that day and that's what I needed, but it changed my life. Couldn't get enough of church. I couldn't get enough. Couldn't get enough of church. Talked about it this morning. We laughed about it because you've all been through this. And even got to a point in my Christian maturity in that first year. I was like, I need to go to something. They were telling me a men's retreat. Who's been on that? Don't lie. Who's been on that? Yeah, did that scare you too? Going up in the woods with 70 old dudes? Right? Yeah? No, you'll be safe. It's fine. Don't worry. But I knew I needed to learn more about this because ultimately every single thing, every truth we'll ever know in life comes from here. And I didn't know this. I didn't know this. So I was mature enough to know, well, the only way I'm going to learn about it is to keep taking a step forward. And I ran into a buddy of mine. I didn't even know he was a Christian. He started going to my church, and we looked at each other, and he's a little bit bigger than me. And I said, well, if you go, I'll go. He said, if you go, I'll go. So we went. So we go to this men's retreat, and reluctantly. And the first night we're there, we go on a midnight hike, and we come back. And the young guys that were under 40 all kind of migrated to the basketball court, and everyone else kind of went and do what old people do. I don't know. Took their teeth out and sleep and all that good stuff, right? Right? Okay. No, so it was a wonderful thing. So many great church leaders there, and guys I'd come to respect so much at Bel Air Press throughout that first year I was there. And about 7 of us wound up on the basketball court, and praise God, that was my first Bible study group. Isn't that cool how God has a plan? It's awesome. So those 7 guys, we all lived on the west side in Santa Monica, California, where I live with my lovely wife, Charity, and she's in the front row here, and she's still shaking her head at me. You know, it's like, just stick with the plan. And I met her shortly after this men's retreat. God worked on me for about 2 years, and I learned the word. My life was on straight for the first time. I just become a good person. I knew why he had me in California. I knew why he had me as an actor on TV and film sets and commercial sets. And then I met the first Christian girl I ever dated. And we'll be married 10 years this July. Wonderful, wonderful woman. And we have 2 babies. My daughter, Karis, just turned 4. And she's a darling, sweet, wonderful angel. A leaf will fall out of a tree, and she'll pick it up and say, oh, we need to put it back with its family. She'll pray for that leaf. She's amazing. What you pour into your children, what comes out of them every single day, and what they pour into us, what we're reminded of how we're supposed to be like children when we fall before the Lord, right? It's a beautiful relationship that we have. And then my little boy, Justice, is 2.5. God bless your child care today. We call him the blonde Tim Tebow. Anybody know Tim Tebow? He's a monster of a football player, 6'5", 250. My little boy is kind of the same way. If he were here, he'd try to pick up this podium. Da-da! He's just said, he's a man, he's a boy, he's amazing. He's tearing up that child care right now. Take your time. We're going to go long today. No, I'm kidding. He's an angel. He's so sweet and so affectionate. We're so blessed that God turned my life around. But the cool thing about not growing up with God, I know pain, I know hardship, I know what it feels like. I know loss. I grew up hungry and in need, like real need, with a single mom in the 70s. My mom got remarried in high school to this very, very ugly man. I dealt with abuse for years. So I know what it's like to not have anybody to turn to. No one. Zero. All of a sudden, I've turned 30, and all those things are still going to happen in our life. We're still going to have pain. We're still going to have hardship. We're going to have rejection. I'm an actor living in Hollywood. Come on. But now we have Jesus in our life. So I feel like I've got the answers to the test. Nothing's that hard anymore. I've lived a lifetime without him, and now I have him. I've had him for 15 years. Yes, I'm 45. Don't tell Hollywood. Don't tell Hollywood. So it's been such a wonderful blessing and gift, and became an actor and did really well the last 5 years. It's been such a gift and such a blessing. I bartended my whole first many, many years before I knew the Lord and was able to steer out of that and put faith in what God was going to do. And he put me in more film and television sets for a big reason. And that's not to go in there and pull out my Bible and, you know, throw holy water on people and recite scripture. I'm not that person. Not a lot of us are like that. God calls people to do that. It's wonderful and great. But not me and not my family and not us. It's go out and try to be an example of just love. Be happy. Be a light. And that will open a conversation. That will open a conversation. And not just the pro-life world, but that's why he had me out here. So I worked and I did these wonderful, great things. And I worked with some Academy Award winners, Jennifer Connelly and Greg Kinnear. We're working. Life is good, right? Getting her some dresses every now and then. We're starting to hit our stride. No babies yet, so we're really full of energy all the time. And I pray, God, you know, I want to make a difference, and I want to be the next Jason Bourne. I'm a fighter, and I want to do these great action movies, but I also want to do something for you. I want to do something. And, you know, the pro-life message has kind of always rubbed me the wrong way. It's the way the world received it, how the world defined it. Now I thought, what's wrong with the world? You have two groups of people, one standing on one side saying, hey, save this baby's life somehow, whatever it takes, help this woman, help. Another saying, no, we can do what we want. It doesn't matter, we don't care, don't tell us what to do. And these loving people are the ones who are wrong. It just blew my mind. So somewhere inside was this, I didn't know how, I was this unsettled about what it meant to be pro-life, and I didn't even know what it meant to be pro-life. I just knew somehow, some way I could never do that. I never wanted to throw a burning Bible at people in an abortion clinic, never wanted to do all that. And so I prayed, God, send me something I can do for you this year. And I got this script for this movie called Voiceless. And I read it, and it was beautiful. And I wept when I read it. The story was so good. Who's read a lot of books, and you watch a movie, and it's like, but the book was great, right? That's not this case. Just put it out there. You'll decide tonight. But I read the screenplay, and it was beautiful. I thought, wow, if I could write a story, how I want to tell the world what it means to be pro-life, this is it. This is it. It's imperfect. This guy doesn't know what he's doing, but he just does something. He's making a change. And his church was not engaged, and God told him to do something. And then a lot of great things, God worked through one person because he took a step forward. God wants us all to do that. So doing a pro-life movie, and I started to do some research and statistics like all the movies I do. So I started researching this guy, and you guys saw in the trailer, ex-war veteran, moves to Philadelphia to start an outreach program to get the kids off the streets, teach them how to box and fight, and teach them about God in the process. Abortion clinic opens up, and you can imagine what happens. His marriage turns against him, the church turns against him because he wants to do something. And so I started researching what that meant. What would that be like? And I was blown away. I was blown away. 60 million little, tiny, sweet, innocent babies have been taken from the world. Since 1973, 60 million. And it doesn't stop. That's in the church. That's out of the church. 1 million a year. 1 million abortions a year. So tomorrow morning is Monday morning. 3,000 young girls will wake up tomorrow morning with a burning in their gut, tears in their eyes, no love, no support, lost. and they will walk out and make the worst decision they've ever made in their life. 3,000 girls will walk out tomorrow and go have an abortion. And then Tuesday morning, and then Wednesday morning, and then Thursday, 3,000 girls every day in our country have to go make that decision by themselves. No family, no church. 83% of churches in our countries, 83% of evangelical churches have no pro-life presence or expression. They don't talk about what God says. God, the truth, the book of life, says about abortion or life. They do not talk about it from the pulpit into the congregation. So if these 3,000 girls can't talk to us about it, in Ralph's, in the grocery store, wherever they are with their friends, where are they going to go? They're going to go to the abortion clinic and think that's the only choice they have. And that's what they're doing. It's a shame. So 83% of churches don't talk about it. Doesn't mean they don't believe in it. They just don't talk about it. What's happening with that? That's disheartening. The family value system is so broken down. 83% of women as well that have abortions are unmarried. People just having sex all over the place. There's no values because this isn't being talked about. Right? It's not being talked about. But it's a really hard thing to talk about. I know a lot of churches don't talk about it because of that reason. And I'm not one of those guys that points a finger. I just believe and I know, hey, Rusty, you're an actor, you're in Hollywood. Are you pro-life? And I hold up my iPhone and I show pictures of my kids. And I say, absolutely, I'm pro-life. I don't get on a soapbox and start preaching who's going to hell and who's not. But I say, absolutely, I am. Can I tell you what that means to me? Here's how I define it. Here's how the God I believe in defines it. But it's so hard to talk about today, especially in the church, because we're powerful. We're in a movement right now for equality, and God bless that, right? God bless that equality in every definition of the word. But how dare you, government, tell me what I can do with my body? How dare you? Well, in the church, what does God say about what you need to do with your body? It's a very, very, very tough thing to talk about when it comes to the truth, even for people in the church. And that's so hard. What does God say about it? Not policy, not our friends, not our husbands or wives. Man, we're flesh, and it's hard to talk about a lot of things God talks about, isn't it? God tells us to do. 2018, the flesh is killing us. It's tearing us apart. It's tearing the church apart. Good people. The flesh is, because we got this whole thing, all the beautiful truth in here, all the hard truth that keeps boundaries around us, that keeps us in God's protective love the whole time. We've got this whole thing. This is the ultimate filter in life. If you put all your faith in your local government leaders, your federal government leaders, you put all your faith in them, man, we're in trouble. We're in trouble. Because no matter how much they promise to love you and protect you and serve you, they will never love and protect and serve you the way this book will. The truth in here. Amen? Amen. Well, then why aren't we listening to this? Why aren't we listening to this when it comes to a lot of the truths that's ripping our country apart? See, this is the ultimate filter system. We got the word and we have flesh. Right? We hold the word up above us. All this wonderful truth in here that'll never change filters down through the flesh. We walk outside with the bits and pieces we want that fits our agenda, what's going on in our lifestyles, what we need to hear, what we need to feel good about ourselves. Filters down through the flesh, and we only have bits and pieces, and the flesh walks out the door with just bits and pieces of the truth, and that's not why it was written. That's why so much is happening in our lives that hurts us still. We've got Jesus in our life, and we're still hurting. Got it upside down. The old saying, you listen to old gospel music, says always stand on the word, right? You got to flip-flop. The flesh needs to be here. All the broken, lonely lies the devil puts into our head on a daily basis about everything, all our hurts and pains, we filter it down through the word of God. And what comes out the other side? Only the word of God. Amen? Amen? And as hard as that is to swallow, the truth about life and the unborn is in here. So no matter what policy ever says about what we can do with our bodies or can't do with our bodies, what does God say about what we need to do with our bodies? And what he, in Isaiah 44:20 said, I'm the creator of life. I'm the creator of all things. So let's see what he says. It's all in here. We're going to pick just a few of these. If you guys have your Bibles, open it up to it's not going to bite you now. We're talking the truth. Open that beautiful thing up to Deuteronomy chapter 30. I'll read it for you guys, and then we'll start with verse 19. And I love this. I love this. The word of God says, chapter 30, verse 19, I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. And God says right here, therefore choose life that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him, for he is your life and length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Right there, the Old Testament, Deuteronomy. God says, choose life. God bless your church for saying these things, speaking them from the pulpit. That's it, from the pulpit, through the congregation, through the body of Christ, out the doors, everywhere you go. But if we don't hear the truth from God, even know that this chapter in Deuteronomy is there, how are we going to live by that, all right? You know, church is so wonderful. They support organizations like the one back here, the High Desert Pregnancy Clinic. There's girls in your own community. They're fighting abortion, trying to figure out what to do. They don't have parents that love and support them. They don't have anyone saying, hey, we'll help you guys. You know, keep that baby. God calls up the body of Christ to do something, open up a clinic like this. Well, they need love, they need support, they need funds, and your church does that. So bless your church, speaking the truth from here, down through there, and out those doors into the world, and that's how we're going to do it. That's it. And the story's all through the Bible. But the thing is, these 3,000 girls, if they can't turn to the church, where can they go? They're going to get an abortion. They don't know Jesus. They don't know Jesus, all right? So we got to share the love of God with them. We have to share the love of God with them because there is hope. Of the 60 million babies that have already been taken from us, imagine the hurt and the pain circling around the country we live in from all that hurt and pain. Well, God's there waiting with his arms open. We got to figure out how to start that conversation with the ones that have already been through that and the ones that are about to go through it. Teach them about a man named Jesus and then what he calls repentance. One of the greatest stories in the Bible, and we all know this man, God loved him. He had one of the greatest hearts for God written in this entire book, but also probably the greatest story of sin and repentance there is. King David. Wonderful, powerful. Most powerful man on the planet Earth. No warrior like him. God used him in so many mighty ways. But David was a man. He was flesh. David saw a beautiful woman named Bathsheba, and sin entered his heart. And he committed multiple sins because he's a fleshly man. And through that, separated himself from God. He was a sinner. God was angry. Angry. David did a terrible thing. Murder, adultery, lust, all of it. Sent the man off to go die in war so he could have his wife. Terrible. One of the greatest men of God we know. He pulled away from God. He didn't hear from God for about a year, almost a year. David was without God. David repented. He didn't ask for forgiveness. He repented, and God knew his heart. God knew his heart. David married Bathsheba, and all that sin and all that he did wrong, he repented because God knew his heart. And what did God do in that sin? How did God turn that around to show all of us, even in the sin of 60 million abortions with repentance, what can God do? What did God do? He gave King David a son, changed the world we live in, changed this whole book. The wisest man who ever walked the face of the earth, Solomon, came from David. Look what he did after that sin of repentance. He gave David Solomon. changed the world, the wisest man to ever walk the face of the earth. And why was he wise? Man, did Solomon have a heart for God? Unselfish, disciplined. So I love Solomon's prayer, basically seeking wisdom from God. So in 1 Kings chapter 3, I'm going to just kind of hop around really fast. Starting about verse 6, chapter 3, verse 6, Solomon loved the Lord. The Lord said, well, what would you like, my son? And Solomon said, you have shown great and steadfast love to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in faithfulness and righteousness, uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord, my God, I love this part right here. You've made your servant king in the place of David. But I'm a child. He doesn't know what he's doing. He doesn't know how to come out or go in. I'm in the midst of a great many people, too many to count, too many in multitude. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this, your great people? It pleased the Lord, and this is so beautiful, it's how God works when we come to know him. It pleased the Lord that Solomon asked this, and God said to him, because you've asked for this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, behold, I now, according to the word, I give you a wise and discerning mind that none like you has been seen before you, and none shall arise after you. And I also give you what you didn't ask for, both riches and honor, so no other king should ever compare to you in all your days. Wow. That's simple. Selfless. Give me wisdom. Give me wisdom. Can we learn from Solomon? Can we learn from Solomon? Unselfishly, give us wisdom. How can we serve you, O God? How can we step in the path of these 3,000 girls every day? We can't be there. The body of Christ can certainly be there, not outside this church. 100 million Christians are serving today, worshiping. Pray, Lord God, these 3,000 women, Lord God, I don't know what it would feel like to start my day like that. Somehow, allow me to bump into one of them somewhere along the way. God, put it on the heart for that doctor and that nurse to not be able to pick up that utensil, to not go in there and do that today. No more. Put it on their hearts. As the body of Christ prays in multitude, God can work through that. Absolutely, God can work through that. Because without Jesus in our lives, the world will crush us. The world is crushing these 3,000 girls every single day. Crushing them, crushing marriages. This movie, this little tiny movie God allowed to happen and release, it's been so wonderful, so effective at bridging the gap to somehow start the conversation with churches. 1 in 3 women in churches, outside the church, inside the church, by the time they're 40 years old, have an abortion. 1 in 3. It's just the truth. It's a reality. It's not going to change the church. It just shows you how much pain and hurt's out there that no one's talked about it. We've shown this movie so many times and God's used it in so many ways. I'm just this Georgia boy who cares about God and cares about these babies, and God put me on the stage to show this movie. And afterwards, I've had a married couple come up to me and say, we had an abortion, we were 17, didn't know God, didn't know the Lord, we had an abortion. We haven't talked about it in 20 years. We saw your movie and we went and saw Christian counseling and we're healed. How amazing is that? Praise God, right? Praise God for that. Because of a movie, guys. So if we're not doing something, 3,000 women walk out the door every single day. So we got to somehow spread a man named Jesus, the truth of who he is, to these young women. Because without Jesus, life will certainly crush us. So 2016 was the most challenging year of my life personally and my family's life personally. I had a best friend. Her name was Mimi. She was my 90-year-old grandmother. She was a wonderful Southern belle, just a wonderful, great woman, one of the only two people in my family that knew Jesus and knew of him and talked about him. Wonderful woman, and became one of my best friends the last 5 years. because my lovely wife told me that I need to get more engaged with my family and make sure I stay talking to them more often, as we should, because I didn't grow up in a really tight family, and she did, and I've seen the beauty of what that can be. So I started calling this old lady, called my grandmother, and man, how beautiful is that? She was smart and funny and had great stories and traveled the world, and I thought, wow, she's not old. She's interesting. We don't know that until you get on the phone with the grandparents, right? And they are wonderful people with these great stories, and so she became one of my best friends. And because every single time I called her, she picked up the phone and answered. Every time. Who does that, right? No one. Sorry, honey, I don't do it either. So I talked to her every single day, and she became my best friend. It was wonderful and great, and she came to the end, you know, close to the end of her life. We knew it was coming. She was 90, and her health turned really quickly, and she was in hospice for about 30-something days. And I was working on the East Coast a lot that year, did a couple projects, and got to visit with her quite a bit and spend those last days with her. And it was just tough, and it was hard. Even understanding heaven and knowing what was going on because I knew the Lord, it was hard, it was tough. And then she got bed sores and got hard and heavy and pain a lot. I was like, man, this just doesn't seem right, you know? If you're going to heaven, God, just open your arms and take her in. And it's got longer and longer and more pain and more pain. And I just thought, man, this just isn't fair. Why is this taking this route? And then she passed away, and one of my best friends was gone, and involuntarily, I just want to pick up the phone and call every day, because that's what I did for 5 years, and the hurt and the pain of losing a close friend, because I was really the first one as an adult that had death in my family, and I thought, man, if I didn't know Jesus, what would this be like? What kind of unfair situation would this be in? How mad would I be at God to watch an old person sit in bed and be in that much pain for that long? Why? But thank God I knew Jesus at that moment, because it helped me through it, because I knew where she was. And my grandmother had taken care of my father, who was in a bad car wreck when I was young. He's been in a wheelchair since I was 5, and didn't really know him or have a relationship because of that. And so my Mimi took care of him my whole life, and she was so worried about my dad. So worried about him, who was going to take care of my dad. And I said, Mimi, he's my father. I'm going to take care of him. Don't you worry. You know, he's good. We've got him. We'll take care of him. And that was June, and July was our 8-year anniversary. We're about to go on a vacation. And I promised my Mimi, I said, Dad's going to come on vacation with us. He's going to take him on vacation with us. He's going to be fine. He's going to become a part of our family. You don't have to worry. So July came around, and we honored what I told my Mimi, and we flew to Alabama and picked up my dad. And he hasn't been out of his house, extended vacation, in 40 years. He has a head trauma, and he's very regimented with a schedule, what he needs to do. Everything has to kind of be the same, because he didn't enjoy going outside. But I made him go, and it was wonderful. He put his toes in the sand for the first time in 40 years. It was really beautiful and great. And got to play with my kids, and we had a really, really good time. And I picked him up, put him in the truck, the wheelchair, the whole thing. It was wonderful. It was great. And my wife, God bless her. God bless her. She said something you don't hear a lot of women say to their in-laws and mother-in-law, well, it's only fair if your dad comes, and we need to bring your mom. I have a Southern mom. You think I can talk a lot? Man, she can talk your ears off, right? And it's just one of those things. Mom, I just cut my hand. It's bleeding. It's on fire. And, well, baby, hold on. Let's just talk a minute. We'll talk about mom. One of those kind, right? Incredible. So Charity had this wonderful idea, and it was very fair. It was great. So 3 or 4 days into the trip, I take my dad back to Montgomery. I pick up my mom. We drive back to Florida. And, oh, does she have the most wonderful time. So great. So wonderful. Watch my little boy trying to learn how to walk. He was almost 1 at the time. Wonderful, beautiful time. It was really great to spend time with family. And took her back home. We fly back to California. We're kind of floating on a high from a really good vacation with our family. First time we'd done that ever, especially as a married couple. And one morning, Charity's out for a run, and I'm getting the kids ready for school, and she comes back in from her run, and she's crying and crying. I said, babe, what's wrong? She said, your mom is dead. I'm thinking, what? She said, your mom, your cousin just called. They found your mom dead this morning. We were just home 2 weeks ago. And all these feelings coming to my brain and my heart, and don't know what to do. And so I get on the phone, I find out what's happening, and start putting plans into motion to get back to Alabama to be with my family and I'm the only one that's organized and functional in my whole family, out of my brothers. And my youngest brother is in the military. He just got into Kuwait about 4 days before. Just gotten stationed, so I'm on the phone with the American Red Cross trying to get him back, trying to figure things out, and the whole time trying to figure out, my mom is 63 years old. So my mom had severe rheumatoid arthritis, so severe she had both wrists, all her knuckles and both hands replaced. Her knees were really bad, she could barely walk. I mean, she was really, really affected by this terrible disease. So she was sick for many years, but nothing where we thought that death was coming. But because of her condition, she was on medication, and sometimes she would disappear for a week at a time, whether she was hurting too much or something was happening. So it was kind of used to my mom disappearing for a week. We got back from our trip, and I talked to her, and I thought, well, this is what mom does. She's probably really tired from our trip. And then we find out from my family, my mom had been by herself for 11 days, dead by herself 11 days. And what that does to a son who loved his mom, and the anger and the rage sort of pouring through my body. I want to blame every single person I knew, my family, blame them all, my wife, blame her, not giving me enough time to spend with my mom, how someone could sit there for that long by herself. I was torn. God was the farthest thing from me. So we get on the plane, we go there, and I'm dealing with it. Writing her eulogy and trying to work my way through it and just praying, God, please give me the strength to just speak the truth about who you are, because my mom loved the Lord. She prayed all the time. And I knew if one thing she would want from her funeral, if somebody in my family, about 80 people there, if one person could come to know the Lord from her death, and she was happy. And I knew that's what she would want. So it's the hardest thing I ever wrote. And in that process, I couldn't get out of my head that my mom was all alone for so long. It was killing me. And I know it was killing my wife, and it was killing the way I was treating my children, my family. And so that night, as I was preparing, Jared and I were talking about it, and God revealed something and said that, Rusty, your mom was not alone. Your mom was not alone. She sat there in her little green chair, a little styrofoam full of food, a little iPhone and a can of Coke, sitting there about 7:30 at night. She always does, by herself, happy. All of a sudden, the room just got really, really quiet. It got warm. And my mom, she heard a voice, said, Cindy. She looked up and he said, I'm here. She held up her little broken hand. I mean, you couldn't even, her hand was like this. Held it up and reached to where the sound came from. And she looked at her finger and she watched her hand straighten out like a miracle, perfectly healthy. And she watched her arm before she knew it, the blink of an eye. Mom was in heaven and she had a perfectly healthy body she hadn't seen in 40 years. Perfectly healthy. The second she closed her eyes, right? That's how the God we love and serve, that's how he works. Yes, their body was there for 11 days, but the second my mom blinked, she was in heaven. She was not alone. She had a perfectly healthy body. Perfectly healthy body. Hugging my Mimi, who had just gotten there a month before. And I thought, man. I told my wife, I said, what if we didn't know Jesus right now? What if I didn't know Jesus? What would happen to our marriage? I blame everybody. Wanted to blame her for not letting me talk to my mom enough. Wanted to blame my family for not going to visit her when they live a half mile down the street. I would have ruined that eulogy. Nobody would have known who God was. Nobody would have known his love. The night before that funeral, the eulogy, he told me that she was not alone. What if we didn't know Jesus? Right? So everything went wonderful and great. Cousins talked about God when we went to church, and we felt just a difference. God was in the room. It was wonderful and great. And before we'd gone home July, we found out we were pregnant again with our third child. It's awesome. This happened so fast. We've been pregnant twice. I don't know how we didn't know. And we were leaving to go on a Sunday back to Georgia. And on a Wednesday, we actually went in for the very first ultrasound. And we're so excited. We had a wonderful doctor and did the ultrasound. And the doctor said, well, I don't know, something doesn't look quite right with the ultrasound. And we need to send you guys over to the specialist that we'd seen with the other two because our other two children, and no baby's perfect. This is how the medical system works. They want you to go see a lot of doctors. So we were thinking, okay, well, maybe it's something similar to that. And there was some concern there. And so the earliest we could get to see the doctor was on a Friday. It was a Wednesday. But we could just see something in our doctor's face that someone was just a little different. Some kind of a chromosome issue, but not Down syndrome, but another chromosome issue. But she wasn't sure. So, you know, got on the phone immediately with Charity's family. Her dad's an ordained minister, great man of God. Everyone's praying, God, please give us a healthy baby. We want a healthy child. Please, Lord, please work a miracle so we can tell the world you worked a miracle in our family. Please, Lord God. Everyone's praying. We go in Friday morning to see a specialist. He doesn't waste any time. He's looking at the ultrasound. He says, yeah, it's the 13th chromosome, which is really severe. It's not Down syndrome. This one's really severe. And in my 20 years experience, babies usually don't live inside the womb for more than 19, 20 weeks, but certainly not outside the womb for more than a couple of weeks. It was devastating. We prayed hard. And then he says, well, let's talk about options. I said, excuse me? He said, well, this baby's not going to live. We need to talk about some options. How to abort the baby. And I thought, are you kidding me? Here I am traveling the country talking to churches about a pro-life movie, listening to testimony every church I go to about women who've been through this exact same conversation, that their child might be Down syndrome or some other problem. And here I am, a doctor asking me that I want to talk about options of abortion. I couldn't believe it. And I asked the doctor, would you mind leaving so my wife and I, we can just talk and pray. And Jared and I, we were hugging and she was crying. And I'd never seen this kind of emotion coming out of her before. It was really hard. We prayed. Cried for I don't know how long. And then all of a sudden, Charity just stopped crying. She just stopped. Complete stop. And she looked at me and she said, God just took this baby home. And she had a miscarriage right there in the doctor's office on the table. And I'm looking at her. She said, I'm at perfect peace. I know God has our baby. And we hugged and we hugged and we hugged. I said, do you realize what just happened? God answered our prayers. We asked for a perfectly healthy baby with a perfectly healthy body. And the only way God knew he could do that was to take him to heaven right there on that moment. So God answered our prayers. He gave us a baby with a perfectly healthy body. And we'll meet that baby one day, but just not right there. How beautiful and wonderful God we have. He answered our prayers. There was so much peace that came with that, that watching the strength of this woman go through. I just kept thinking, how lucky are we? What if we didn't know Jesus right now, this moment? What would happen to our marriage? I could barely breathe the last 2 days knowing something wasn't right inside my wife's womb. Imagine if we had to go 7, 8, 9, 10 more weeks because we knew God was going to take this baby when he wanted to, not when we wanted to. Imagine how we could function as a married couple at work, with our friends, anything, with that kind of pain going on inside of us. God is such a good God. He didn't make us go through that. He was so good. He honored our prayers. He gave us a healthy baby right there in heaven. We didn't have to suffer through that pain. God loved us that much. That's what he did for us. We call her Miracle. My daughter prays for her every single night. Blessing. So great. What if we didn't know Jesus? I don't even know how long we would have stayed married. I don't know. Who knows? The power of how God can transform lives and what Jesus can do in our life. Without Jesus, the world will crush us. It was hard for us. These 3,000 women, they don't have that choice. They don't know who Jesus is. They don't have families who love them. Girls are committing suicide. They can't handle the pressure after their abortion. What is happening? So we as a church, how are we going to get involved and do something to try and make a difference for the kingdom? We got to start praying for these girls first and foremost. Somehow, some way, we step into their lives, or God, please send them a Christian that day to step into their lives, because we can't. Right? God will figure out how to close that abortion clinic. They're a business. You take away their customers, what happens? The doors close. It just happens. I've heard story after story after story after story. But without Jesus, life is crushing our country. It's crushing these young girls, these young boys who are dealing with this. So when you see your pastors, you hug them and you say, thank you for being a pro-life church. Thank you for speaking the truth to us. Thank you for allowing a movie like this to come and speak to us about what's happening to the world. It changed my life. I can't stop. This movie's over a year and a half ago. But it wasn't enough. God, now what? Now what can I do? And with this movie, they brought us CareNet, who has a ton of pregnancy resource centers all over the country that supported us. We did a PSA for them because I pushed for it. Human Coalition, they've got a million people online. It used to be called Online for Life, praying for this every single day. They've got the same pregnancy resource centers all over the country, educating, equipping, teaching these young girls how to be moms. We organize, we partner with a group called Save the Storks, and you guys support them, and you probably here to support them financially with donations. They build mobile pregnancy centers, state-of-the-art mobile pregnancy centers. They park right in front of Planned Parenthood, right in front of abortion clinics. In the body of Christ, you are standing on the sidewalk saying, hey, what's your name? These girls are crying. What's your name? Can I talk for a second? What's going on? You want to come get a free ultrasound? You want to hear your baby's heartbeat? 4 out of 5 girls that walk on that bus choose life for their babies. 4 out of 5. It's amazing. Yes. The very first bus that was ever built was in Englewood, New Jersey. Very first bus ever parked in front of a abortion clinic. 390 young girls walked on that bus. 390 women that chose abortion. I'm going to end this baby's life for whatever those reasons. All 390 chose life. All of them. Praise God. Amazing. What God has shown us that we can do, the body of Christ, this vessel here, what we can do to try and help make a difference in the world. So if you guys don't know what that is or how you can do it, pray about it. See where God wants to send you. I know a lot of you are already supporting Save the Storks. If you're not, ask your pastor how you can do it or this pregnancy resource center back here that's right here in your community. There's girls live in this community. They're going in there to teach them how to be moms. They give them diapers and strollers, educating them. In the whole process, they're learning about who? A man named Jesus. In the process, not only one life is saved, two lives are saved, mama and baby, right? Praise God for that. Amen for that. So I'm just so excited to be a part of it. So you guys will just figure out, pray really hard for these girls every single day because it's not going to stop. Till the body of Christ raises up and gets out there and does something because he's proven to us with companies like Save the Storks. This works. God's doing it through his people. He's doing it through us to do something. So I said, God, send me somewhere every single weekend. If you can, I'll talk about it. I'll show this movie. I'll talk about it because I've seen the healings happen. Women who haven't talked about it come up crying. My daughter would be 30 years old today had my daddy not pressured me into doing something like that. It's heart-wrenching. We're here to do something, to pray about it, and hug them and love them because it's very, 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 very real. And I talked to a lot of women, and it's the common denominator for what they say. It's always the same. I go to church. I know I've been forgiven. I've been prayed for. But I can't forgive myself. And that's killing these women who've dealt with this. So I want to end by praying if I can. And thank you guys for coming out, watch the movie tonight. It's wonderful, it's great. I'll be there to talk to you guys afterwards about it. It's a powerful thing that's really making a difference. A small little thing that God used is making a difference in our culture. But we have to be the ones through media to tell the world what it means to be a Christian and tell the world what it means to be a pro-life Christian at that. Amen. So Father God, we come to you today as a body of Christ with questions, with doubts, with anger, with frustration, with hurt, and with pain. Well, God, I don't want policy telling me what to do. Can you somehow tell me what to do? Can you drown out the voices of what my flesh and my heart wants to say to defend myself when, Lord God, I really need to defend what you say about it and share what you say about it with others. God, speak to our hearts today about what that is. I don't know what that is, Lord. Lead me in your word to what that is. Father, I pray right now for women maybe in this congregation that somewhere in their heart they had to make that decision. And it's been hurting them. And they don't know what to do, Lord. I pray that at some point, somehow they come forward to their church leaders, the women in their church, their pastor, and talk about it, get prayed for. Because, Lord God, we know you're waiting to love them and wrap them in a warmth. They have never felt the repentance. Strengthen these pastors, Lord God, to continue to fight the fight. Well, the world thinks that we're ugly and we're mean and hateful because we choose life. We stand for it. Strengthen them, Lord God. Strengthen them with your word and your truth to endure the battle that is ahead, Lord God. I pray for these students at Calvary Chapel Bible Institute, Lord. Equip them. They are the future. They are today. They are tomorrow. They're the ones who are going to rewrite policy. They're the ones who are going to change the world, our culture, for what it means to be pro-love. Pro-love, the ultimate choice, pro-love. Equip these pregnancy resource centers, the one you have right here, High Desert, with funds and volunteers and help and love and support. May their cupboards be overflowing with things they need to help these young girls become better mothers, take care of their kids, Lord God. I pray for the moms and the dads whose daughters had to go through abortion. Pray for the hurt they're feeling. Strengthen them. Gather them closely to you, Lord God, for healing. Just so grateful, so thankful for this time to get up here and to share the truth that you've written and you've shared with us, Lord God. May we always stand on the word. May your word always be the filter, Lord God. We know it will never change. It will always love us. It will always endure. Just so grateful and humbled to be called followers of you. So thank you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right, everyone. Let's thank Rusty for coming today. And I just wanted, before we go, just real quickly, one theme that he kept saying over and over again through all the hard times that he has been through and his wife has been through, what if I didn't know Jesus? Maybe today you're sitting in that spot and you're like, I'll tell you what it felt like to not know Jesus and go through those things. Because maybe today you don't know Jesus and you are on that edge. You don't understand what to do. You're here only because you're searching for Jesus. Well, today he's pulling on your heart, and we just want to give you a chance to accept Jesus. Confess with your mouth, believe in your heart, and you will be saved. And so as a church, we're going to repeat this prayer. And if you want to repeat it with us, it has nothing to do with any magical formula or anything like that. You're just accepting what the Lord has done and his work on the cross to take away all your sins. You can't fix yourself. Stop trying. It's the Lord that will fix you. Amen. So church, let's pray. Repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I do believe that you are the Messiah, that you died, that you rose again, that I might live. Lord Jesus, fill me full of your Holy Spirit, that I may live for you the rest of my days. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, everybody.